Waiting on the Lord, by faith receiving, waiting in the upper room. The power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, power, the power they had at Pentecost. Waiting on the Lord for the promise given. Waiting on the Lord to send from heaven. Waiting on the Lord by faith receiving. Waiting in the upper room. The power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, the power, the power they had at Pentecost. Oh, waiting on the Lord for the promise given. Waiting on the Lord to send from heaven. Waiting on the Lord by faith receiving. Waiting in the upper room. The power, the power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, the power they had at Pentecost. Waiting on the Lord, longing to mount higher. Waiting on the Lord, having great desire. Waiting on the Lord for the heavenly fire. Waiting in the upper room. The power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, the power they had at Pentecost. The power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, the power they had at Pentecost.
Thank you, Father.
The power, it's victory over sin and purity within. The power, the power they had at Pentecost.
Thank you, God. Praise God. That's what I'm looking for, more of the Pentecostal power. Yes, more and more and more when you've had a taste of something like that. Yeah, there's no end to wanting more. Amen. Right on, Chris. Praise God. Hallelujah. Be seated for a skinny minute. I just wanted to talk about something here for a second. And hi, how you doing, Sparky? I'm good. Good to see you. I've been getting a lot of questions lately about Haiti, because everybody's been seeing the kidnapping that happened this week of the missionaries in Port-au-Prince. And they're warning us, and they're asking, are we still going? And the answer is yes, we are still going. And you say, are you crazy in the head? Well, if normally I am, but in this case I'm not. The reason why we're still going is because the violence is in the capital city of Port-au-Prince. And Port-au-Prince in relationship to where we are now would be like us being in Oakdale and kidnappings happening in New York City. And we know kidnappings happen in New York City all the time right now. Are you afraid? Do you feel like you're in danger? See, we're not going to be flying into Port-au-Prince. We're going to be flying into the Dominican Republic. And we're going to tiptoe over the border. We're going to be 2.5 hours north of any violence. We're going to have a lot of security. We're going to be with Dr. Franco and his wife and his daughter. And I spoke to Dr. Franco yesterday, and he said, if it was this much of a chance of you being kidnapped, I would not go. Okay. So it's very, very safe where we're going. We're not going to be where all the violence is happening. He even checked with the head of the police in that area, and he said you could walk the streets at night there, if they had streets, of course, but every streets. So it's very, very safe. That's why we're still going, because number one, it's safe. Number two, we're going for the kids. And there's work to be done there, and we feel called to go. And so we still will be going, so we covet your prayers. Not going until December, but we need to pray for the people that were kidnapped because they did a very foolish thing. They should not have been in Port-au-Prince. They should not have gone there. They probably went because there was a need. Yes, they were building an orphanage, and we know what that's like. When there's a need, we want to go. But it really wasn't wisdom on their part to be in that area because it's very, very, very dangerous. Even the locals will stay away from that area. So we'll be praying for them. So that's the answer for those of you who keep sending me pictures of what's going on in Haiti, and I do appreciate that. So we do covet your prayers. Hallelujah. So let's stand and open in prayer. We've been having some great prayer mornings here, and I'm so loving that. And Jesse and Glenn are with us tonight and tomorrow night, and that's it. They're leaving on Thursday, so we got to try to use them and abuse them as much as we can over the next 48 hours to get as much out of them as we can. I've been so enjoying this, so thank you, thank you. Well, let's pray. Father, you are a good, good Father. You know what we need, when we need it, and if we keep our ears and eyes and hearts open, we receive. You're not a late God, you're an on-time God, and this is an on-time gathering with on-time messages. Lord Jesus, we praise you and we thank you for pouring into us, oh God. And Father, tonight without exception, keep it pouring. Keep it pouring, keep it pouring, keep it pouring, because Lord, we've tasted of you and we love what we've tasted. We desire more and more and more and more. And God, we will do our work. We will do our work. We receive the word, Lord. We embrace the word, God. We allow you to come in and change us and challenge us and use us in this day. That's why we're here on a Tuesday night. There's nothing more important than hearing from you this night, God. We're so grateful, so extremely grateful. And we thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do. We pray an outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon Glenn and Jesse, oh God, because they have given of themselves sacrificially and tremendously over these last couple of days. And we want them to receive more than they have given, God. More than they have given to us. Bless them abundantly, Father. And so, God, we promise to get out of the way tonight. And you have your way. Receive our praise and worship now. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's worship the Lord. Hallelujah.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, as the trumpet calls. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And though these are days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world, and we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, as the trumpet calls. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Oh, there's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, has a trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, has a trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, has a trumpet called. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, has a trumpet called. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, how beautiful are you, Lord. It's your words, it's your love. Oh, how glorious are you, Lord. It's your power. It was your cross that saved me, that saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there set me free. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. Oh, how beautiful are you, Lord. It's your word, it's your love. Oh, how glorious are you, Lord. It's your power. It was your cross that saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there set me free. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. With a crown of thorns, with a crown of thorns, you became a king forever. With a crown of thorns, you became a king forever. With a crown of thorns, you became a king forever. With a crown of thorns, with a crown of thorns, you became a king forever. That saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there, set me free. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. Give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. We give you glory, Lord. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. Oh, you're worthy, Lord. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. Oh, we give you glory, Jesus. You're worthy, God. You're worthy, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we just wanna be with you? I just wanna be with you, King of glory. Fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. King of glory, fill this place. King of glory, fill this place. King of glory, King of glory, fill this place. King of King of healing, King of healing, fill this place. King of my peace, King of my peace, fill this place. King of my joy, fill this place. King of power, King of glory, King of glory, King of glory. We sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah, 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 oh sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. King of glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. Oh, King of glory, King of glory, fill this place. King of glory, King of glory, fill this place. King of glory, fill this place. King of healing, fill this place. King of my peace, fill this place. King of my joy, fill this plain. King of power, King of glory, King of glory, King of glory. We sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah, 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 sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. Just want to be with you. Oh, we just want to be with you, Lord. Hallelujah. Fill this place, Lord. Fill this place, Holy Spirit. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Inhabit the praise of your people, Lord. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. need you more. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you more. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my old life. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more, Lord, than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you more than yesterday. I need yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you more. Oh, we need you more. I need you more. More than yesterday. More than yesterday. Song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything, oh, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my old life. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you more. yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. Need you more than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. We need you, Jesus. We need you. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will.
Speed.
Think about the words that you sing. Hope so. Hope it's more than a song, but it's here. Sometimes we sing words, we're not quite at that point, but we want to be. And we've got to the part that says, search me and try me. It made me think that many of our troubles really are an answer to our prayers. Say, God, search me. Doesn't always feel comfortable. And try me, trials will come our way. An answer to our prayers. Try me, God. Okay, here you go. There you go. And we don't always handle that right. We have the wrong attitude sometimes in the middle of our trials. Oh, why is this happening to me? Instead of, okay, how can I use this for God's glory? Everything in life with the Lord is a lesson. I've learned that many times. Every single thing. To use the scripture, all things work together for good, means I've got to do my part for it to work for good. I don't whine my way through it. But I say, okay, God, what good is going to come out of this? And let him search us, let him try us, let him test us. And hopefully we come out shining as gold, right, Chris?
Right.
Yeah, I ran. I'm big right over there. So just a thought tonight as we're singing those songs. Take those songs to heart. God is so good to pull out certain words when we're singing and say, that's you, daughter, that's you. Amen. Praise God. Well, hallelujah. I'm looking forward to tonight's message, and it's been so sweet. And let's see what God's got for us tonight. Are you ready for this? Tighten your seatbelts. Okay, get out your notebooks. Let's and Charles, would you pray? Would you pray over our speaker, please? Put your mic up so that they hear you out there. Thank you.
We didn't
would you come, my brother? Thank you, Philip and Charles, for that wonderful worship tonight. Oh, yes.
Good evening. Hey, you got some good tones back there. Thank you, Jesus. All right. How'd that happen again? Camera. Why didn't roll the camera? iPads, I'll tell you. Goofy thing. I guess I got to do it that way. Thank you, Jesus. There we go. Well, Father, bless this message in Jesus' name. Amen. Give us ears to hear, sweet Jesus. I've heard it said that one of the signs of insanity is that you keep doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result. And I think that's pretty true. So you can have a guy that's beating his head against the wall, and he's hoping that one of those times is going to feel good. You know, he's being crazy. You know, that's just insanity. And as people, we can do the same thing. We can just be going over the same thing, doing the same stuff, and expecting something different. But if we've been doing the same thing, and it's producing one thing, it's going to continue producing that same thing. And so we need something that's going to change. What I want to do this evening is I want to look at the idea as Gentiles think. And we'll be in Ephesians chapter 4. So you can turn there. As Gentiles think. And I will actually be at various places in this message, just pulling from some prior thought that I've had in a couple of the messages already, so I'll be just trying to tie some thoughts together. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 17. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Actually, a very disturbing verse here, just in what it's really revealing of the condition of the unsaved world. And so what Paul is doing here is he's giving us a command, and it's actually a very strong command. So he's not just saying, would you do this? Please do this, or it's my suggestion that you do this. He says, so I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord. So he's insisting on it, but he's not insisting on it from his own authority. He's insisting on it from the authority of the Lord. So he says, I am pressing you to do this because this is God's will. So if you want to know God's will, tonight we're going to look at one expression of his will that's just revealed in these verses here. And so when you begin to look at it, we're commanded not to live as the Gentiles do. And what is the idea of Gentiles? Well, the actual idea of Gentiles is everybody that's non-Jews. And so from that standpoint, there's only two types of people, Jews and non-Jews. But Paul is changing this all up. So he's going to make a difference between those who are the true people of God, not that they are children of Abraham, but they're children of Abraham by faith. So the true people of God, contrasting them with the Gentiles or non-believers. And the Gentiles, of course, even as he was using it back then, is very broad. So in his day, they had all kinds of people in all parts of the world, known world at that time. They had different religions and different philosophies and different cultures and all this stuff that was there. And he went and took all of them and just clumped them into one idea of the Gentile world. And we can still do that today. It's the same identical thing. We may have a more diverse world in the sense of greater goofiness and false beliefs and idols and all the other junk, but it is still the aspect that there is only two classes of people, according to the Word of God, those who are true followers of Jesus and those who aren't. And everyone who is of the Gentile class, of the non-believer, that takes in everybody. It's irrelevant if they are American, if they've been born and raised in some religion in America, or whether they're from the Middle East and Muslim, or from India and Hindu, or whatever. It's, you know, all those have different cultural dynamics, but they are all in the same category of unsaved, and they are unsaved because they think as unsaved people. And so if we are going to be any different, we have to think different. And so that's really what this is all about. It's about how we think and what God wants to do in transforming our thinking process. Because if we don't allow Him to transform the way we think, we're going to continue doing what we've been doing and just be insane. You know, it'll be a sign of insanity. We keep doing the same thing instead of allowing Jesus to change us. And so he refers to the futility of their thinking. Futility is just the idea of worthlessness, of that which is vain, has no value to it. And so they are living a life, and they're living the life that they're living because their thinking is worthless. It has no value, nothing of substance that can do them any good. Even if it produces wealth in this world or some particular things they want in this world, it is still in the end, from an eternal perspective, utterly, completely worthless. There is no true value in it. And they are darkened in their understanding. They are darkened. They are blind to the truth. And they are blind to the truth because they want to be blind to the truth. They are willfully ignorant of these things. And so as a result, they are separated from the life of God. They are separated from the life of God, and it gives more definition because of the ignorance that's in them due to the hardening of their hearts. They have hardened their hearts against God. And the beginning of the hardening of the heart actually begins before anybody has really come to the place to even hear the name Jesus. They harden themselves to the conscience that God has given them, to what they know inside of them from right and wrong, which is not cultural, but is the aspect of how God has made us, that within us there is this reality of right and wrong, and we know it. And when we violate what is wrong, we have that understanding. We feel it. That's why people, when they do something, maybe they've never been really told that it's wrong, but the first time they do it and it's wrong, they feel that it's wrong. They sense it. They have some form of shame or guilt or whatever it is, because God has put that in us. But here you have these Gentiles. They are thinking in dark ways because that's where their thoughts are. Their life is worthless because they're pursuing these things. They're separated from the life of God because they are ignorant of God, but they are willfully ignorant because they've hardened their hearts against God. Then he goes on to say that they have lost all sensitivity. You see, that's what happens when we harden our heart. Now, the thing is, you have people that are unsaved out there. Their hearts are hard as can be. They don't want the gospel. They don't want to know anything about it. Maybe they've heard about Jesus. They want to live the way that they want to live. They've hardened their hearts in that. The scary thing is people in the church that are not right with God, and they've hardened their hearts as well. Now, there's a lot of churches out there that don't preach the truth. And shame on that pastor that will allow people to sit under their preaching and never come under conviction. That man or woman will stand before God. Your pastor isn't like that. All right, but there's all kinds of them out there. And it's a shame, because what happens is, as they leave people in their sin and they go to church, they think they're okay. They're losing sensitivity to the Spirit of God. They are not being convicted over their sin, so it hardens their heart even more to it, and they become harder to reach because now they have the religious aspect to their life, but they're deceived and they think they're okay. And then it says they have given themselves over to sensuality. Now, this has been a problem throughout the history of mankind and sin, but there's never been a culture like the American culture that has so built a country around sensuality, around self-indulgence. And so that's what they do. They give themselves a sensuality and indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. You see, that's what happens. If we harden our hearts, we begin to give ourselves into the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And as we do that, we will go after more and more. And the whole degrading process gets worse and worse. And in that whole process as well, we are hardening our hearts against God. That's why people who backslide, they are in very dangerous place, because they don't understand what that sin can do. In the story of the prodigal son, we have one boy that went astray and came back. How many are still out there? How many are still out there that they have allowed the hardening of their heart because they began to think like Gentiles? They began to think like Gentiles. They began to think like the world. And I can't remember what it was. Maybe we were praying or something one of the mornings here. I think that's what it was. But somebody was praying about the voices of this world. I wrote an article a long time ago called Voices, and it just is about the aspect of the voices of this world that are screaming at us, that are trying to manipulate us, calling us, wooing us, trying to pull us away. And even in the midst of all this, then we have the still small voice of the Lord. He's not going to try and scream above it. He can, but he's not going to. We have to want to hear that still small voice, and we have to be willing to focus our life to hear that. And so we do have this world that is screaming at us, trying to drag us away, trying to teach us its ways and its morality and all the worthlessness of this life. And if we open the door a little bit, we could be drug away in ways we don't even understand. And so that word futility that Paul uses here, some translate as vanity, but the actual Greek word means moral depravity. So he says, in their morally depraved way of thinking. So they are thinking in a depraved way that takes them into all the expressions that I just kind of highlighted there. When we think like the world, we're going to act like the world. There's no way we can change our actions until we begin to see our minds transformed. That's why when you go to Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it's about the surrendered life. It's about not conforming to the world, but what? Allowing our minds to be transformed. And he could have said heart, but he didn't. He said our minds need to be transformed, because if our minds aren't transformed, our heart is going to go after what our mind is thinking. And the heart and mind are so interwoven, you can't really separate one from the other. What the heart loves, it thinks on, what the life thinks upon is what they end up loving. And so as if we want to change the whole direction of that, we have to begin to change how we think. And when you look at Christians that are living in defeat, they are living in defeat because they are thinking wrong. This isn't about positive thinking. This isn't about some of the goofy craziness out there, but it is about God transforming the way that we think, that we begin to think upon what is right and good and holy and just, and as we dwell upon those things, we begin to love those things. And as we love those things, we cease loving what we once clung to. And so thinking like the world is going to harden our hearts. It's going to harden our hearts. And you know, that's what happens so many times. People do not backslide in a moment. They don't backslide in a moment. They begin to open themselves up, and guaranteed at the core of that is two things: forsaking their first love, but they begin to think like the world. They begin to think like the world, so they start going after what the world is offering, believing the lies of all these voices that are saying, if you want to be happy, this is what you need, and they rebel against God because they're believing these lies. And I guarantee you, that lies are being unleashed in this nation, in this world, greater than we've ever understood. There are devils loose. Why do you think that we've gone so insane into this whole sexual revolution and all the perversion that's come out of it? Jesse just heard a very sad thing today about a girl that she was counseling, and the girl just didn't want to leave her life of sin. Now she's gone. And they don't even know where she is, and she's gone into a homosexual, full-blown homosexual lifestyle. I guarantee you, behind it all is this thinking of the world, the lies that she heard, the lies that fed the lust of the flesh inside of her, saying, this is what you are, and took her in ways that now is going to be so hard to get out of. God can deliver people from homosexuality, but there's something about homosexuality that's different than any other sin. All other sins are natural. Homosexuality is even against nature itself. And there's a rebellion in it that is so deep-rooted. People can find deliverance, but I'll tell you what, it's one fierce devil to have to fight. It's a seriously big problem. And so if we open the door to evil, it will come in and it will cause us nightmares. Now, I'm going to be going some other places here, and we'll be building upon this thought in various ways, but when you look at the story in the Gospel of Mark, and at least three of the Gospels give the story, but in the Gospel of Mark, it's the story of the demoniac that had a legion of demons in him. And we are not told how he got in that condition. A friend of mine lent me a commentary that he had just bought, and he really ended up liking it, and it happened to be of the Gospel of Luke. And since I'm doing Luke in my podcast, I figured I'd borrow it from him for a little bit. I gave it back. And, you know, it wasn't too bad, but there was something there. You could tell this man did not understand spiritual things that was doing this commentary, because he gets into the situation of this demoniac, and he ends up more or less saying, well, the guy didn't do this. This wasn't his fault that he was demon-possessed. He was more like a man that's walking along, and he's being taken by bandits. And I'm going, this guy's missed everything. You know, you don't even understand the spiritual realm. And you're writing this down as if to be authoritative, and you think you know something? You see, nobody gets demon-possessed unless they open themselves up to it. That means they must open themselves up to sin. The devil cannot take people captive unless they are willing to be taken captive. And so that's a serious thing. This man did something in his life, went down a path that opened up the door to the demonic, and it was so big that he opened himself up to that he just didn't have one little devil, he had 1,000 of them. So this was a serious situation, the choice of a will that took him in this way. And then the misery of that life that came out of what he pursued at one time that thought would bring him happiness, now he is in absolute misery, in bondage to the devil that is just abusing him, and he's cutting himself, and he's beating himself, and terrorizing everybody, living among the tombs, just crazy, miserable life. And then what happens, Jesus? You know, it's just, he's just astounding. You know, just like he went and went out of his way to go into the territory of the Samaritans, where the Jews don't go into, they go around it. He goes into it purposely for one woman, for the purpose of what? Reaching that one woman, because when she was saved, she would take the word of what happened to her into that village in Samaria, and revival would break out. And so Jesus stayed and ministered there as a result. This is the same identical thing that's going to happen, same thing. So he crosses the Sea of Galilee, and when you look at all these various names of the Sea of Galilee, it's not because it necessarily has a bunch of names, it's just that's what the locals call it. So Luke, in being an excellent historian, ends up using the local name for the Sea of Galilee. And so he crosses and goes to where this demoniac is at, for the demoniac. Not for, in one sense, anybody else. Yes, it would affect a tremendous amount of people. But he went through all this for this one man, to bring deliverance to this one man. Now, through this, he had a bigger plan, so it was going to be much more than that. But in Mark chapter 5, verse 15, it says, when they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by a legion of demons sitting there, dressed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Think about that. Here's this demon-possessed man that's delivered. He was naked, cut to pieces of bruised scars, and now he's dressed and he's in his right mind, and people are afraid of a man that's dressed and in his right mind. Right? I mean, they're terrified of this man. He was insane. He was thinking insane. He lived an insane life. They weren't so bothered by that. Okay, leave him alone. We tried chaining him up. He breaks the chains. Just leave him alone. Let him do his own thing. But now, the demoniac set free, he's starting to think right. And they're afraid of him. You know, and the more right we think, the more the world will be afraid of us. I mean, it's just the reality of it. They're not afraid of us when we think like them. When the church acts like the world, they're not bothered. But when we are delivered from our devils, and we start coming to a place of real relation with Christ, and we start thinking right, or at least learning how to think better, we're getting there more and more, then they get afraid of us, because then we become a threat to them. And of course, this is after the demons spoke up and says, well, instead of sending us to hell right now, would you send us into a bunch of pigs? And Jesus allowed that because the pigs were an unclean food in Israel, and they shouldn't have even been there. So yes, go on the pigs, and the pigs went crazy, okay? Those same devils drove the man crazy. Now they drove the pigs crazy, and they went off the cliff. This is a lot of money. A lot of money went over the cliff into the ocean. A lot of money was lost, and people were angry over the loss of money. And the shepherds, I don't know if you call them shepherds, what do you call people that herd pigs? The pig herders, okay? The pig herders, I mean, they didn't want to get in trouble for it. It wasn't their fault. And so they tried to rouse up everybody. This is what happened. Look at this. And they're terrified because the man is in his right mind. Now, this is an old statistic. Only 6% of American Christians have a Christian worldview. What worldview means is worldview encapsulates all that we think about life and reason for being and the existence of God or not according to a person's worldview. And all that we think, everybody that has a thinking mind has a worldview. They may not have systematically laid it out, they may have not figured it out, but if you ask them their opinions about life, they'll give you your worldview, their worldview. Everybody has it. The world acts like the world because one way or the other they have a secular worldview, even if they are religious, even if they're Muslim or Buddhist or Mormon. They think in a particular way because they have grabbed hold of some form of worldly thinking that is defining their life. And so here's this man now in his right mind. And you know, the 6% used to be just some years ago, 9%. You see, we're losing more and more of the church because it's more and more rejecting a Christian worldview. And if we do not think like Christians, we will not act like Christians. You want to know why the worldliness is in the church? Because they're still believing what the world teaches. And until they think otherwise, they will not change. They will continue still being worldly people with worldly ambitions and just wanting to add a little bit of God to it enough so that they can go to heaven. But it doesn't work like that. They won't make it. So what happens to the demoniac? This demoniac, now that's delivered, I don't know what he called him now, ex-demoniac, you know? I mean, so, you know, this man that's been delivered, he wants to go with Jesus. You know, I mean, it's like the change is so radical. He wants to follow Jesus, but Jesus says, no, I don't want you to follow me here this way. But you go back to your hometown and you tell everybody what great things God has done for you. And what happened then? He goes back to his hometown, which is Decapolis. And actually, Decapolis means 10 cities. So it was an area, small area, that basically had these 10 real cities. And he went back there and started testifying. They knew the man. All he had to do was look at his arms and body and everything else, all the scars and bruises that were there, and give evidence. I was the madman. I was the man that was out there and everybody was so afraid of. And now Jesus has come and cast those devils out and given me a good mind, a right mind. And they were probably terrified of him there. But that became a catalyst of revival, that when Jesus came to the area of the Decapolis, revival broke out. People were flooding to him because of the demoniac, because that man was set free, and he gave evidence of the reality of coming to his sanity. We will not impress the world if we think and act like the world. They've got the world. They know it doesn't work. They don't really want another one. They don't know how to get out of what they're in. It's not meeting their needs, but they're so filled with self that they are, if I might say it like this, in a certain way, content with the insanity of their life. Until we live out something and we demonstrate it because we are thinking right and thinking right is producing this right life, they're not going to be interested. And so James and John, and you know, I just appreciate this because, you know, the Word of God doesn't just say all the nice things about people. It brings out the ugly stuff as well. So this is a very ugly thing about James and John here, okay, a very ugly event. And but what happens is they come to Jesus and they ask him to be seated on his right and on his left when he comes to his kingdom. Now, one of the gospel accounts ends up saying Mama was involved in it as well. So I don't doubt that Mama, in her own arrogance, was promoting her boys to try and get the best position. Now, we've got to understand what this is all about. They viewed Messiah not as what Messiah was. They took the Old Testament prophecies about Christ's first coming and second coming, mingled them together because they had no ability to separate them, and they thought that Messiah was going to come, give them victory over their enemies, over Rome and Herod and all that. So they looked at him as a military leader that would eventually become the king of Israel. And if you go to that man and you say, I want to be on your right side, and the other says, I want to be on your left side, they're saying, I want to be number two, and my brother wants to be number three in the kingdom. What raw selfishness. It was just a lust for power, a lust for greed. They were thinking like the world. They were thinking like the world, and so they had the desires of the world. And, you know, I mean, Jesus sometimes was brutal, lovingly brutal. You know, scribes and Pharisees, one you scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, man, tore them up. That was the love of God. Sometimes his rebukes were just so, just right there. I mean, he went right after the real thing. And so he could have gone through all kinds of issues with this, but instead he called all the disciples together, and it wasn't long before all the disciples heard of this, and they're all mad at James and John because they all wanted the second place and the third place. So it wasn't that any of them were being noble. They were all filled with the lust of flesh, and I'm glad that God could use them and clean them up and get them straightened out, but it took a long time. So in Mark chapter 10, verse 42, Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many." You want to talk about something utterly and absolutely contrary to everything that the world stands for, this is it. Okay, boys, you want to be number one and number two, you become the greatest servant, and then maybe you might get some kind of position. But until you become the servant, you are going to still be filled with so much arrogance, so much self, so much ambition that is selfish, that I can't do in your life what I want to do. And so what a great rebuke, but it became a rebuke to all of them, because all of them were vying for some kind of position. All of them wanted something because they did not understand Messiah and his coming. It took his death and resurrection for them to separate the prophecies of his first coming from the second. So that was the only way they could do it. And so Jesus straightened all this out eventually. But you see, this is the kind of stuff that's in our heart, and this is what comes out of us when we think wrong. And you know what? When we think wrong, we don't think we think wrong. I mean, you understand, that's the danger of it. We think everything's okay. We think we got it down. I mean, we want to convert the world to how we think, instead of understanding that maybe I'm not too sane here, you know? Maybe I'm not quite thinking right, and I need to think differently. And so there's two ways of thinking, two worldviews, only two worldviews. And so the first is as Gentiles think, and this is humanistic and man-centered. That's what humanism means, would be man-centered. And individualistic, which is all about me, and it's selfish, which is all about my personal happiness. That fills all the world, no matter what religion, no matter what they pursue or their philosophy or anything else, that fills every single one outside of Christ. But how are Christians supposed to think? It is to be God-centered, not self-centered. It is to be servant-oriented, so that it's about God and others and not about us and our advancement. And it's to be selfless, not selfish. I mean, Jesus turns everything upside down on us. You know, you thought wrong for so long. It's not about you. It's not about your happiness. It's not about all the ambitions that you have and the dreams that you have. It's not about that, because the majority of ambitions and dreams we have are all selfish, are all about me, all about my wants. They're all sensual. And if God allowed them to come into our lives, they would ruin us. So let's look a little bit at how Gentiles think. The core of their thinking is going to be humanistic. And it was a philosopher from the 5th century BC. His name was Protagoras. And he gave us the definition for humanism. Very simple. Humanism is where man is the measure of all things. It's all about me. That's humanism. So put whatever religion behind it, and it's still humanism. You know, though there is the formal philosophy called humanism, humanism has touched every single individual. We have had our own version of humanistic understanding in our life, and we try so often without really understanding it, incorporating it into our Christianity. You have people out there that preach false gospels, twisted gospels, that are incorporating humanism into it, and it appeals to people because it appeals to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. That's why they go after these kind of preachers, because they're somehow appealing to their sensual desires and the way that they think. They want those things. God wants you to be rich. And so the preacher that preaches that will pack the church out because that's what people want. It feeds their humanistic tendencies where it's all about me. Now, you have this wonderful setting where Jesus and the disciples are gathered around and they've had a busy day of ministry, Jesus says, who does the people say that I am? You know, they're having a good time. You know, we sometimes, you know, you look at a movie like Jesus of Nazareth, which is a good movie. It's okay. It has a lot of Hollywood. But what do you have as Jesus there? A very stoic man. Very stoic. You know, and I mean, there's some great scenes. I love the scene there where he's, the sinner woman's at the feet in the Pharisee's house. Beautiful scene on what goes on there. But, you know, this Jesus, he just misses it. There's something that's just not there. Because Jesus, I believe he knew how to laugh. He knew how to joke in correct ways. He just had joy. And how can we look at a stoic Jesus and then hear him say, my joy I give you? Well, you know, it's just where? I don't see it in your face. I don't see it in what you say, you know? I mean, so if he's going to say, I'm going to give you my joy, he had to express joy. There had to be this joy in his life. Well, then he gets personal. He always does that, man. You know, great jolly time around the fire. They're all laughing and joking about what everybody's saying about Jesus. And whoa, then he throws this in. Who do you say I am? Okay, let's get down to nitty gritty. Who do you say I am? And then there's silence. Silence, because I don't want to commit myself. You know, it's really what it is. I don't want to commit myself. Well, you know, you pat Peter on the back at this moment because he does something very good. He says, you are the Christ. So what does Jesus say? Flesh and blood did not tell this to you, but my Father in heaven did. Okay? Beautiful situation until the next moment. All right? Because what immediately follows? Peter comes up to Jesus because he had shared with them that he was going to be crucified. And he says, don't let this be. Don't let this happen. You can't let this happen. And what does Jesus say in Matthew chapter 16, verse 23? Jesus turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. I mean, isn't that just crazy? One moment you're hearing from the Father, and the next thing the devil's speaking through you, going, shoo, man, are we fickle people. You know, I mean, it's just crazy. It really is. But do we understand where humanism comes from? Right here, it's spoken of. Here's the source of it. Get behind me, Satan. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Satan turned everything that was to be God-centered into man-centered, got Eve focused upon herself and aroused in her this selfishness that hadn't been there, and she gave in to it, and now we suffer under the fall. This is what he's been doing to mankind again and again, because we don't have in mind the things of God, but our own things, our own ambitions, our own dreams, our own wants. We don't do what he wants. And so as a result, we have all kinds of problems. And you know what happens when we have all kinds of problems? Then we get mad at Jesus for them. We get mad at him because we're not having a fun time. And so the foundation of humanism is that it's all about me. Now, you know, I don't want to get off and I don't want to say things to hurt anybody. I don't know your lives well enough to say anything that's going. But, you know, depression is a very selfish thing. Very selfish, because you know what it's all about? You. It's self-absorption. It's a trap. It's a miserable, terrible, terrible trap. And it takes time to get a person in that. But you know why that happens? Because people think according to humanism. They think it's all about them. I'm not happy. I'm not getting what I want. Life isn't being what I'd like it to be. And all the things, we get self-absorbed. We become humanistic in the way that we approach life. So we begin to complain, we get mad at God and all the other things because of it. This is all inspired from Satan, because as long as the devil can keep us focused on ourselves, we will not focus on Jesus who brings deliverance. So he knows by the sheer aspect of getting our eyes on ourselves, he's bringing defeat to us, because there's no hope of victory in looking at ourselves. No hope. It's a hopeless situation. Look at yourself, and all you're going to see is problems, or if you thought you were some super person, you're still going to be filled with the same problems because you're looking at yourself. Humanism breeds this individualism where it's all about me. All about me. All about my happiness. All about my happiness, right? Isn't that how it works? How many divorces happen because people say, I deserve to be happy. You're not making me happy. I'm going to find somebody that's going to make me happy. I mean, it's just all over. You look at, how do you think that they sell things, they market things with this? I remember this one, I can't remember what it was. I think it was in Arizona. But this guy that was a Christian, he worked for a newspaper, and he says, you know, I'm in the advertising department, and there's three things we put into every ad. If you get a good ad, if you make a good ad that's going to attract people, three things that are put into that: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Every single one. Look at them, whether it's billboards or whatever. They are trying to somehow arouse that in you. You deserve a new Ford today. All this idea is trying to arouse our sensual, selfish desires so we go after what is forbidden, which keeps us away from Christ. A man named Ray Stedman said, we are brainwashed by Western thinking. Those of us reared in the Western world have been programmed to behave as individualists. I mean, this is America. This is the way it works. And, you know, yes, there's other cultures that don't have the fierce individualism that we have, but they are still thinking like Gentiles. They just have a different dynamic, and I don't need to talk about that because we're Americans, okay? And so humanism also is about this love of self. Lovers of self leads to lovers of pleasure that leads to lovers of money. See, that's really how it goes, because when we make ourselves the center and we want happiness, we end up realizing from a worldly standpoint that happiness costs money. So then you become a lover of money because you want to be happy. But guess what? It never does what it promises. Can't give because it's just a lie. And so we already dealt with this in one of the other messages, 2 Timothy chapter 3. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. Why? Because people will be lovers of themselves. Humanism gone amok. You know, it's what it comes down to be. And until we start getting deliverance from ourselves, from the humanism that is so interwoven into the way we think and to what we believe, unless we start getting deliverance from that, we will not change how we think. Therefore, we will not change how we act. There must be a radical change of thinking until there can be a radical transformation of life. And so what happens out of all this, we become consumed with the material world. And, you know, ministering in the Southwest, you know, we've ministered at inner city Phoenix Church, and you know where the church was at that time, it was right next to a park, and so the police would come in, clear out the park of all the homeless people. They'd all pick up their cardboard houses and go to another park, and then they'd go from there to another park 2 weeks later, and then they'd end up back here. You know, they just went through the cycle. It was the thing, yo, I got to kick them out after 2 weeks, and you know, they're not trying to get rid of them, they're just moving them around. And you can go up to somebody with their shopping cart that is homeless, and they don't want to not be homeless. I can't tell you how many times I've dealt with homeless people. They don't want to not be homeless. They are there either from drug addiction or they just don't want the other life. Try and take their shopping cart from them, and you'll have a battle. You see, they can be as possessive of their possessions as a millionaire is of his. It's not the amount of money. It's the nature of the person. It's what's inside of us naturally. So we become a people that are consumed with the material world. Philippians 3:19 says, their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach. Their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things. This defines the world. This is the way the world thinks. This is the way the world acts. But see, we are to be different. Totally, completely different. So we are to begin to think like Jesus. But to think like Jesus is alien to this world. It's not like you can go someplace in this world and say, there's a place in this world where people think like Christ. It's not there naturally. This is a supernatural thing. This is another kingdom breaking into this kingdom that's at war with God, that's in rebellion against God, and he's bringing into this kingdom a right way of thinking to people that have thought insane for all their life, and he's transforming them. Then he makes them little lights in this world of people that were former filled with legions. Now they begin to think rightly. They become these little lights then that he's spreading through the world. And so as if we want to begin to think right, we've got to go to the source, because the right way of thinking is to think like Jesus. But you know, we will not think any different until we want to think different. So if you're happy with the way everything is in your life, well, guess what? You're going to stay just the way you are, because you're not going to pay the price to think differently, because it's going to be some work. I guarantee you, it just doesn't happen. You just don't wake up in the morning and say, I'm not going to think like I've done for the last 20, 30, 40 years. You know, I mean, it's like, it just doesn't work like that. There are things so ingrained in us that cause us to think wrong that we don't even understand it. I've been in the faith for 47 years. Man, there's still so much of that junk. And, you know, it just comes out at various points. You go, wow, that's crazy. Where in the world did that come from? You know, because it comes out of our old sinful nature, out of what we naturally are without God. And so we have to become people that make a purposeful pursuit to stop thinking like the world. Now, they have an old computer saying, garbage in, garbage out. You sit in front of the television, you're going to garbage in, you're going to garbage out, and you'll be like an insane person saying, I want to be like Jesus, I want to be like Jesus, while you're taking in the garbage of the world, and it's ridiculous. Unless you change, unless you cut off the voice of the world to you, unless you stop listening to those voices, you make the purposeful thing, say, I will not let that speak to me anymore. Unless you shut it off, you're going to keep thinking like that. Because they become a voice, really, when you look at it, with how much people watch television, how much the church watches television, the voice of the world is speaking to them way more than the Bible does, than prayer does, than church does. So if they're thinking, if they're taking in the world, they're going to think like the world, they may go and say, oh, it's not affecting me. You don't even know what you're talking about. You don't even understand how deceived that you are then. Because you take the garbage in, garbage is going to come out, and there's no way it's going to be otherwise. You can go to Jesus all you want and say, oh, God, I want to love you. I want to serve you. And here you are holding on to hell. And he says, I can't do anything until you're going to let go. I can't change anything in your life until you're willing to let go of this wrong way of thinking that has defined your life and kept you trapped in what you're in. And so in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul goes on in verses 20 through 24. He says, you, however, did not come to know Christ that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. There is so much there, I don't have time to get into it. I'm just going to highlight a very important thing here that's really the core of what biblical counseling is all about, but it's about what biblical Christianity is. It's about putting off the old life and then putting on a new life. It must be a choice. Until you put off the old life, you can't put on a new life. As long as we cling to the old life, we will cling to those very things that will ruin us, and until we let go of those things, we put them off, we can't put on the new. You understand? This is so simple of Christianity, so basic, but yet so many people don't even understand it. Now, this has been often referred to, especially in older writings, as living the crucified life. This is the crucified life. You die to your old sinful nature so that the new life in Christ can rise up in you. It must be purposeful. If you are waiting for it to happen in your life by osmosis or whatever, it's just not going to happen. You've got to make the choice. You've got to make the choice. And so we have to put off the old man and put on the new. Now, how do we do that? You see, where our mind is where our heart will be. We can't separate these two. They are so interwoven with each other, there's no ability to say that I function by the mind and not the heart. I mean, it's just not true. Or we go by the heart, not the mind. They are both so interwoven that even it's hard sometimes to separate them in Scripture. There are times that it is brought to a pretty clear place so as well. But where our mind is where our heart will be. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. Right? We looked at that. We touched on the aspect of love, of what that really is. And so if we are going to want to change our heart, we've got to change our mind in how we think about it. So James and John had some very, very worldly ways of thinking. I want to be number two, and my younger brother, he wants to be number three in the kingdom. We want to be a somebody. We want to be the ones that's in power under Jesus, and nothing is going to change in them until they change the way they think. Nothing. They will not love the Lord anymore until they change the way they think. You understand? Our love for God cannot grow if we are thinking wrong. Now, we can think wrong and go to God and say, God, help clean up my way of thinking. And he will do that. And in the process, he will help us to love him through it. Because the greater our love is for him, the greater the motivation we will have to think right. The more we will recognize how we are not thinking right and cry out to him for the grace to change. You see, it is going to be fulfilling this first command or the effort to try and do so that's going to be the motivation to get all the other junk out of our life, to begin to think right, to understand that the crucified life he calls us to is a wonderful life. Does it have the pain of dying? Absolutely. But when we are crucified, when something in our life has been crucified, then we have a promise of resurrection life in his place. He brings life out of what we died to. Until we died to it, there'll be no life. We'll stay in that death. We'll stay in that particular thing that will just continue to cause us harm and misery. So John ended up saying in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. In another place, he says to love the world is hatred towards God. Now, you know what's so strange about that? You can have people that call themselves Christians that are very worldly. Why are they worldly? Because they're rich. Worldliness has nothing to do with richness. It has to be loving the world, loving what the world has to give, loving the ways of the world. And so they can, went on a rabbit trail and got off. I don't know where I was. That's all right. We'll move on then. I'll probably remember in a little bit, and it'll be too late to bring it in. You know, when I was a young Christian, you know, I'd come out of a life of drugs, and boy, as a young pastor, man, I did that constantly. It was bad. So actually, God has been healing my mind. It's getting better all the time. Yeah. So, but you see, if we want to think differently, then we really do need to concentrate on where the affection of the heart is. We have to. Because if we love what is evil, if we love what is wrong, if we make ourselves about what we love, it's all about my happiness, then we will not be seeking after the love of God, to love him better, to love him deeper, and to get rid of all the things that we wrongly love. We can love what is evil. So what do they say all the time? You know, in all these various ways, you know, if it's love, it must be right. What a stupid saying. What a stupid saying. You know, where in the world they get that from? I know where they got it from, hell. It certainly didn't come from the Word of God. It didn't come from God himself. We can love what is evil. We do love what is evil. We have loved our sin. We have loved our selfish ways. When we love ourselves, we, in essence, abuse ourselves, and we continue doing it because we love ourselves even though we're hurting ourselves. It's crazy. We are insane people without Christ. And so we must become people that begin to purposely pursue the love of God, purposely pursuing the place to love him more, crying out, making it an active part of our life, help me to love you more, because by loving him more, I will begin to understand what is contrary to him and want to put those things off and go through the agony of what it is to put things off in my life that should be put off. Now, it's not going to be easy. Jesus never told you it would be easy, you know, but we have to understand the value of it to do it no matter what. And so in John chapter 5, I've already brought this verse out in one of the other messages. And so Jesus said in John chapter 5, verse 30, by myself I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just. For I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. You see, he thought different. And that's why I have said so many times before that the most disturbing person this world has ever known has been Jesus. And we try to say it otherwise. Oh, he's the most loving person. Absolutely. But his love was not like our love. His love was a holy love. He was disturbing. He was disturbing. I mean, his very presence would convict. I mean, we don't really understand. Everything in his life was about pleasing the Father. We don't comprehend that. If, you know, we like to do pie charts. So if we did a pie chart and we did what we do during the day and where our heart and mind is during the day, how much of that day would be all about you and how much of that day would be about Jesus? I'd be afraid to really see what is. Well, you got this little sliver of maybe 2%, okay? All the rest of it is me in one way or the other. You see, we don't understand how radical that is. But there's something in this that is so necessary because that is where life is found. Focusing upon Jesus, getting our eyes off of ourselves. When we have become people that is always focused on ourselves, you know how hard that is to get your eyes off of you? It is seriously hard stuff. It's battles. And I guarantee you, if you want to get your eyes off of you and get your eyes on Jesus, you're going to have to fight some devils because devils don't want to let you go. I would imagine, it's just a guess, devils don't know the future, but when the devils saw that Jesus was coming and they were guessing, what's here? Nothing's here. There's a madman, a demoniac. What is he going after him? And they may have started giving that man some serious trouble. Because the devils don't want us to think right, doesn't want us to get the ways of the world out of us, doesn't want us to stop thinking worldly. And when we start to do it, then it upsets a whole lot. And so part of the thing that has to be done in our life is simple in what it says, but it's a challenge. And it can be done, though. And what does he say in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2? Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. So here's the thing. We are naturally self-absorbed, okay? All of us. We are naturally self-absorbed. The only way we can get out of that must be a purposeful act, that we do exactly what's here, that we begin to set our heart on things above, and we begin to set our mind on things above. That's why if you are taking garbage in, you need to cut the garbage off, because you're still taking garbage in, and the garbage in is going to continue to corrupt you more and more and more. Shut it off. If you have this monster that's being a nightmare to you, if you keep feeding the monster's only going to continue to grow. If you want to get rid of the monster, you cut off the food supply. You shut it off. You do away with it. You says, no more. Now, you know, we're going to have the problem as Americans. We've got to have noise constantly. I mean, is there a store you can go into anymore where they don't have music playing? A restaurant? You know, it's like, where is there some place of silence that, you know, can we go to a restaurant and just talk and not have to hear AC/DC or whatever it is that's blaring over the speakers? I mean, it's just crazy how it is today. The constant noise. And do you remember the times that you've gone into that restaurant or Walmart's and you walk out and this worldly song is stuck in your head? You understand how that works? The devil is there trying to get us focused upon the same old stuff, because then those songs, especially, what happens when you got a wrong song in your head? You sing it in your head. And what is 99.9% of them about? One way or the other, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. One way or the other. And so you listen to it, and it goes over and over and over, and it's feeding that flesh life. It's feeding those things unless you grab hold of it and you say, no, I'm not going to. So you know what I do? I change all the lyrics. The melody's there, it got stuck, okay? Until I can put some music in, some worship to change it, I take and I change all the words and I start singing to Jesus. It's what I do constantly. And it may make absolutely no sense, but I'm going, I'm not going to let this get in my head and start corrupting me. So as soon as I can, I'll put on some worship music and something I really like so that a new song is singing up there and the devil doesn't have this little foothold in to try and corrupt my own heart. If you're listening to secular music, shame on you. You're doing yourself more damage, you understand. You're doing yourself big time damage because everything of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is coming through that music. Everything, feeding everything of the self life. How are you going to change if you keep feeding the monster inside of you with the food from hell? Same thing with television. You may not know how to live without the TV blaring. Learn. Learn. Get rid of the temptation. Cut the cable off, cut the internet off, throw the TV out the window, whatever. And you may sit there and twiddle your thumbs, good time to start praying. And then when you're done that, you begin to read the Word. Because here's the thing, you know, I watch a little bit of, not watch, but I'll read a little bit of news on the internet. And, you know, all right, so I'm trying to go to good conservative sites that really try to tell the truth as much as they understand it. But it's still so laden with lies and stuff of man. And then, you know, you just go, I'm so sick of it. I need the Word. Absolute, pure truth. You understand? You take up so much of the garbage of this world, and you just need to immerse yourself in the Word of God and say, I want truth in my inner parts. I want truth to define me. I want truth to order my life. And it happens by choice. You see, one way of really getting victory over the aspect of depression and self-absorption and all that is worship, powerful stuff. That's why the devil wants to get bad songs in us. But you learn how to worship. You can be absolutely miserable, and you put on some worship, and you force yourself to begin to sing. It may take a little bit of time, and it depends a lot on how fierce the battle's going on at that time, but I guarantee you keep persevering through. And joy will start to fill the heart. Because you've gotten your eyes off of you. You've gotten your eyes off the problem. You've gotten your eyes off of all the issues and all the things going wrong in our world. And you got yourself on the only one who is absolutely, infinitely sane. You understand? That's a serious, serious thing there. And so we need to set our heart and mind on things above. It must be the purposeful act. And because the Word of God is so much an integral part of this, you cannot survive and think right without constantly being in the Word. You must. You see, I don't know how it gets in people's minds that it's like this legalist thing. I got to read the Word. I'm a bad Christian if I don't read the Word. No, you need to read the Word because your life depends on it. And it's just that simple. If you don't take in the truth, lies are going to define you. And if you let lies define you, how far are those lies going to take you then? How far are they going to take you? You need to be a lover of the Word. And especially when you look at a world that is so insane, that is so evil and rushing towards judgment, and you live in that world, we have to live in this filthy world. But yet we should be lovers of the truth that says, all right, I've been in lies all day. It's all around me, everywhere I go. But God, I want to immerse myself in truth. I need some freshness right now. I need truth. We should be lovers of it, want it defining us. So another thing then that is so important with thinking like a believer, like Jesus, is we have to have divine purpose. Why did Jesus come into the world? Was there any question in him? There's no question when he was 12 years old. You understand? At 12 years old, he knew what he was about. He may not have at that time understood the full extent of it, may not have understood he came to be the Lamb of God to die on a cross for mankind, but he understood who his Father was. He understood he was being prepared and he was being trained for a mission to rescue mankind. He understood that. The entirety of his life was with divine purpose. How can we follow Jesus and not be defined by his purpose? And so what happens in this whole self-absorption that everything's about me, I do nothing for anybody else then. It's all about me, about my happiness, about my wants, about my convenience and all these other things. So life is consumed with me. And until my eyes get off of me and begin to look at a hurting world out there, and you want to talk about pain, think about the pain of everyone that is rushing to hell right now and the pain they'll have when they go over the precipice into the pit. And your problems are nothing compared, nothing in comparison. And so we need to be a people with divine purpose. We need to be a people with divine purpose. And I touched on this last night, I think. So Jesus went to Samaria to meet that Samaritan woman. And what happened? The disciples come back after going buying food, and they says, well, we got some food here for you, Master. And Jesus is giving them a lesson that they didn't even understand. Now, I don't doubt that Jesus ate something, but he was using this as an opportunity to teach. And he says, I have food to eat that you don't even understand. You don't even comprehend this food. You haven't even got there. How long had they been following Jesus at this time? I don't know. I don't know the time frame of that event exactly, but, you know, at least a little bit. And they still didn't understand. This was more to the beginning of his ministry because he was still trying to go under the radar until Samaria. Then he started letting everything be ramped up a little bit more and a little bit more until eventually it was just crazy. Just crazy with multitudes pressing upon him. I have food to eat that you don't know anything about. How many Christians know about that food? How many Christians ever ate that table of selfless love, of compassion, of living as what Jesus told the disciples that the greatest is going to be servant of all? How many of us live to serve others? You know where that service first begins? It begins at home, of course. That's where we have to begin to learn it, but it has to go beyond there. It's not enough for it just to be in the home. You have to find a release of that in somehow touching a hurting, dying world, somehow serving within the body of Christ and the reach of the lost. It must be there. And that's why he says, don't say that there's 4 more months to harvest. Look, the fields are white to harvest. Can't you see yet? Are you still blind? Don't you comprehend why he came into this world? Everything about Jesus' mission, there was no time in his life, no time in his ministry that he was just random saying, where do I go today? Everything was purposeful. Everything. He sought the Father's will. He obeyed the Father's will. He went to whatever village, whatever city, whatever it was. He did what the Father told him to do because he was in that place of perfect communion constantly. He ate at the Father's table, if using that kind of illustration, constantly. He's saying, you don't understand this food. You don't understand what I'm really all about. You don't comprehend that life is more than what you have looked at, and I have something more for you than you've yet grasped. And so we have to become a people that are wanting to eat the food that Jesus ate and see the fields white to harvest. There's your mission. That's your reason for being. I saved you that I could work my work inside of you, that I could work my work through you. I didn't save you to sit. I didn't save you to be self-absorbed. I didn't save you to have some comfortable life or to live for prosperity. I saved you for a reason, and you need to be a person with divine purpose. And when you start reaching out to hurting people, that'll be a big, huge help of getting your eyes off of yourself. I remember a little story I heard about David Wilkerson's wife. They had started the Bible school that is in Pennsylvania, and so she was one of the teachers at the Bible school, and she went and says, okay, at such and such a time, we're going to be going to the streets in New York City to witness and minister to the people on the streets. And one of the students went and says, well, I don't feel called to the streets. He says, you go to the streets, you'll feel called. Right? You go to the street, goes right in the midst of pain. Go in the midst of need. Go in the midst of hurting. Go in the midst of people that are suffering. And all of a sudden, things will begin to change. When we live for ourselves, that's all we live for. And we can't see anything else, and we get no benefit, only sorrow out of living for self. One commentator made a statement. He said, society is in a state of moral decay, not because the majority of Americans love degeneracy, but because humanism has exercised more influence in our culture than the church has. Let me close with one final verse. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon the world. Right? Something wrong with that, huh? Okay, yeah. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on me. What does this mean, though? Because you trust in me. You see, having our mind stayed on him is an expression of trust. I trust you are good. I trust you will care for me. I trust you do all things well. And so I'm focused upon you. I'm looking to you. My heart is consumed with you, pursuing you. And so I'm trusting you, and we will find that peace in that place of trust like that. Well, Lord, I really wish that I could preach one message and we all think right. Oh, God, such a work in our brains, in our way of thinking. Lord, dismantle the worldly way of thinking that is still inside of us. Help us to realize what it is, to see it for what it really is, and begin to hate that way of thinking. And that every time we see it coming out of us, that we begin to cry out, God, transform my mind. Help me to think like you. Forgive me for thinking selfish. Forgive me for being self-absorbed. Forgive me for focusing upon everything of myself and not seeing the reality of a perishing world that's rushing to hell. God, forgive me of this worldly way of thinking. Lord, I'm asking you, make us aware of this. Lord, that we might as individuals welcome you. Welcome you into the exposing of these things in our life. And then when you expose them to us, that we would not get angry, but thankful. Because Jesus, what you are doing and exposing it, you are delivering us from those little devils, if I might say it like that, that have kept us bound. So Lord, help us. Help us to be a people that begin to think differently, that we might begin to think like you. And Lord, if we want to think like you, we must study you, we must look at you, we must read about you, we must want to know you. Dear God, you must become the consuming passion of our life. Otherwise, we will continue to do what we've been doing for so long. We ask this in the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I actually want to do a little something different. You are a praying church, so many of you know how to pray. Rather than giving an altar call, because I think this message needs to be taken to heart. I think this message needs to be thought through. And you need to weigh this out and decide whether or not you really want to think differently, whether or not you really want to begin to dismantle your worldly ways of thinking so that you can begin to think like Jesus. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to take a few minutes and for us to pray. And I'm going to ask you, I know many of you are familiar with it, you do it already, but I'm going to ask you to just pray what's on your heart, what God has been speaking to you in these meetings and in the service this evening. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, sweet Spirit, right now. Come, oh God. Come, oh God. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Savior. Just lead out in prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come, Holy Ghost, come, Holy Ghost. Come, sweet Spirit, come, sweet Spirit. Here. as I had mentioned Sunday night when we looked at selfless love, that that is where I fail in loving. That's where I fail most in my life, of not loving right and not loving well. And Lord, at the very center of that are wrong ways of thinking. Lord, never once did you cry for your rights. You could have. You didn't defend yourself before the Sanhedrin Council. You didn't defend yourself before Pilate. You didn't call down the 12 legions of angels that you told Peter that you could. And Lord, when we think wrong, we're going to love poorly or selfishly. So Lord, I ask for grace in my own life to learn how to think correctly about love, to love more like you, Jesus. Thank you, sweet Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe you could lead us in a song or something.
Myself away I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away I give myself away so you can use me. Here I am, here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed. Myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Lord, I give myself away so you can use me. Life is not my own, to you I belong. So I give myself to you. My life is not my own, to you I belong. I give myself to you. And I give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Here I am, here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. So I give myself away. myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself, I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself, I give myself to you. And I give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away. So you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away. So you can use me. Myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me.
Apply what we've learned the last 3 days, our lives will truly be different from this day forward. Like my sister's sweet sister always says, do your work. How many of us are going to do our work and not just be caught up in the moment right now, but to take it home and apply it and chew it and apply it and chew it and apply it. And if you didn't take notes, it's out there on YouTube. And watch it again. Let's not lose what God's been doing. Amen. Father, I thank you for these amazing folks that are here tonight and watching. God, we need this, and you gave us exactly what we needed, God. And now it's our part. We commit to doing our part. We commit to following through because we want to be more like Christ. We want to love like Christ. We want to please the Father. We want to go out and fulfill our purpose, Lord God. Now is the time to do that. So, Lord, we commit to applying those things that you have taught us, shutting down the other voices, shutting down the things that are in the way, grabbing hold of the gift that you gave us tonight and the last couple nights, God. So we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We love you, Lord. Bless us now as we go home, Lord. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Love y'all. Loved y'all. Hey, I get to do 2 baptisms tomorrow. 2 water baptisms. Hallelujah. And a 99-degree jacuzzi. Woo! Hey, pray for Alex and Sam. They're being baptized tomorrow. Hallelujah. Bless God. Bless God. Love you guys. Don't forget, tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock prayer. If you haven't made a prayer meeting, you've got one more chance to be here. And then, of course, Glenn and Jesse will be here tomorrow night. God bless. Good night.